The following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
It's Empty Wheel Friday on the Nicole Sandler Show.
Oh, it is, and it's only been about a decade in the past week that's transpired. Every day, every time we get together on Fridays, me with Marcy Wheeler of Emptywheel.net, we remark about how, well, you said it last week, every week is a year. This time, I think it was a decade.
I know, every week is it's logarithmic or something. Every week is a bigger span of time, you know?
Right.
So, oh boy, can you believe what we went through in the last week?
I wouldn't. If this were a script pitched to a Hollywood studio, they'd go, nah, that's too implausible.
Fuck Aaron Sorkin, man.
Oh, my God. Yes. Thank you. Fuck Aaron Sorkin. What did he say? Mitt Romney should run or something?
Right. Fuck Aaron Sorkin.
Thank you. I was always a big fan, but where the hell did that come from?
Fuck Aaron Sorkin.
So let's see. We last spoke on Friday. We said we'll know something probably by Monday what's going to happen. And I want to get your take on it, Marcy. But, you know, my whole thing is I hate the way it was done. I hate that the Democratic Party aired their dirty laundry in public, that they pressured this man who probably would have stepped down. But in retrospect, it needed to happen, but not the way it did. Right. But we need to get past that. I need to get past that.
Yeah. I mean, look, I think, I think if we go back to 4 weeks ago when you and I first spoke about this, I mean, I know I was always confident that he would drop out and always confident that it would have to be Kamala replacing him.
Yep, me too.
And always confident that she would bring at least two advantages to the ticket. One is stamina and the second is choice, and had the possibility to break the logjam of double haters, right? So mm-hmm. I'm positive I said that 4 weeks ago. I'm positive I have believed that from the start. I think there was a lot of the way in which Joe Biden was taken out, largely on the part of the New York Times. I mean, yes. There was good journalism from different outlets. The New York Times always sucked. And the New York Times along the way violated a number of journalistic ethics. I called this week on Joe Kahn to resign, just yes. like Joe Biden did. And I mean that very seriously. Mm-hmm. And I think certain pundits and consultants, some of whom happened to be close to Barack Obama, some of whom probably were close to Gavin Newsom, who were making sparkle pony plans for how to replace Joe Biden that betrayed that their goals were not to remove Joe Biden because he didn't have the stamina to run. It wasn't about Joe's stamina. It was about them wanting a mulligan on the primaries.
Yeah.
And we didn't have prime. I mean, I'm sympathetic to people who are like Joe Biden, you know, won the way in which they did. It was really bad. But nevertheless, Kamala Harris was elected to step in if Joe Biden couldn't do it, whether it was before or after. She was elected by primary voters. Yep. And I think that was going to have far better legitimacy than any other option. Add in the monetary thing, add in the possibility. I mean, we're up against insurrectionists. You can't really give them any kind of legal leverage. But the other thing that was interesting was the reason we didn't have a primary is because no legitimate contender, whether it's Gavin Newsom or Gretchen Whitmer, is I think the two, mm-hmm. Add in Pritzker.
Yeah.
None of those three legitimate contenders wanted to do something which was to challenge not just an incredibly successful president, right? Because then you'd have to run against an incredibly successful an incredibly successful presidency. There's right. no policy reason to replace Joe Biden. And then the second one is obviously you'd have to run against a black woman,
That's
a woman
right.
of color.
That's right.
And so there was no way to make that transition, no matter how much. And, you know, I love Gretchen Whitmer. I would love mm-hmm. to have Gretchen Whitmer on the ballot, but there was no way to make that transition without splitting the party. And there was even less way to make the transition from Joe Biden to his vice presidential candidate, who was on the ticket with him when the primary voters elected him, chose him by overwhelming numbers. So I'm okay with the process. I'm okay with the choice. I think that honestly, what happened is in many ways a preferential, a better outcome than either the primaries, which I think would have been divisive and would have created real problems with Black Americans, because, you know, you would have said, I'm better than Kamala Harris, and none of those other three people are better than her. They can all make a different candidacy argument than her, but they're not better. And then, and the timing, and by timing, it's not just that Donald Trump is now locked into a regressive douchebag who, internet memes claim falsely likes to fuck couches. And it's not just that it happened, and I made a point about this, it happened in the window before Bibi Netanyahu came. And so yesterday it was Kamala's readout that people cared about. And Kamala's readout was much better on Gaza than Joe Biden has managed. So it gave Kamala a way to pivot from Joe Biden, but it also gave Democrats a way to pivot away from Bibi Netanyahu. And I mean, he might as well be a registered Republican at this point. So
yeah.
That was, I think, really important timing. After their convention, so they've, you know, like it ate up their bump. It ate up whatever bump was going to come from Donald Trump being shot. So the timing could not have been more optimal.
Right. Yeah.
What's that?
Shot at.
He was shot at. We can come back to that. So the time, would I be happy with Gretchen Whitmer on the ticket? Undoubtedly. Absolutely. Would I be furious at a bunch of boys who made arguments about Gavin Newsom being better than Gretchen Whitmer and be bitter going into the general and be bitter about the way that Kamala Harris was pushed aside?
Yep.
You bet. And I would be one of millions of Democrats who would feel that way. And so here we are, unified behind a candidate who is wildly exceeding a lot of people's, not mine, but a lot of people's expectations for her. And Donald Trump and Russia and Donald Trump have wasted 6 years of investment in joint rack fucking and collusion to turn Joe Biden into the Democrat of Democrats. And then, and eventually I'm going to write this post, but I've been meaning to from, you know, 4 weeks ago. We also have a president who has been granted immunity by the Supreme Court, who will oversee ensuring a free and fair election. And we have a candidate who's, except in, you know, when she votes for herself on January 6th, when she votes to certify the ballots on January 6th, her actions as a candidate will be separate from her actions as a vice president. I think given the legal landscape that the Supreme Court just created, I think that that is optimal in the conditions we're in. So I'm, you know, 4 weeks ago, I said this was going to go reasonably well. Mm-hmm. And yes, Joe Biden got beat up in ways that were unconscionable and unconscionable because they were being done by both media and political consultants who were lying about their motives. It wasn't about Joe Biden's stamina. It was, you know, New York Times has an op-ed today saying, you know, Kamala has to give us the interview that Joe Biden never did. I mean, that I'm translating, but they're
right.
What assholes. Yeah. Joe Kahn needs to step down just like Joe Biden did. And then and consultants who wanted a mulligan on the primary that Gavin Newsom or whoever else chose not to run 8 months ago. And importantly, one of the things that's interesting, and I'm babbling on, I know,
it's been
16 years since I last spoke to you. importantly, when people like Gavin Newsom, before he endorsed, and he was the first of these three to endorse, his people were circulating a memo saying Gavin Newsom does better than Kamala, and he quickly endorsed. So Gavin Newsom endorsed. And then Pritzker, when asked in retrospect about why he didn't endorse, he said it was a bit surprising, right? And so did Whitmer when she was asked why she didn't immediately endorse. And remember, Whitmer first said nice things about Biden, and then overnight, that first night, got on a planning call with Kamala's people and, you know, basically endorsed then and then gave a more formal endorsement later that day. And people keep going to her saying, do you want to be a vice president? And she keeps saying, I like Michigan. And knowing Whitmer like I do, I don't know her that well. Right. But I'll remind people that she gave this barn burner of a fundraiser. It was the first political event I went to after Hillary lost in 2016. And you could see at that moment where she was headed. And, you know, she said too, that she, because it was such a surprise, she had to consult with her people. And I think, one of the things that happened is you might have seen a challenge from Pritzker or Whitmer if it hadn't rolled out the way it did. And Biden, by the way, you know, when he was deciding whether or not to drop, he wasn't testing Gavin Newsom against, you know, compared to him or Whitmer. He was testing Kamala Harris. He wanted it, I think, to be his vice president. He wanted it to have that continuity. And the way it rolled out, and I think, you know, a bunch of asshole political pundits were just foolish. Like, Joe Biden has been in this game for 50 years, and he and Kamala both executed perfectly the things they needed to do. And the people who thought that there was going to be this open process were just fooling themselves. And I'm laughing my ass off.
Oh, yes. I'm wondering how much of this Joe Biden orchestrated. You know, obviously the timing of it was just perfect. The way they waited till the end of the Republican convention and boom comes the announcement on Sunday, followed by the endorsement from Joe Biden of Kamala Harris. Like no daylight between the two. It was just 1-2 punch, and the change in attitude was almost immediate. I've got a new slogan for the Harris campaign: change and hope. Instead of hope and, you get it? You know? Because it is. So last night, you know, so last week in this 16-year-long week, there was an organizing call, Black women. And we know, we've talked about this before, and in terms of, you can't skip over Kamala Harris. She's a sitting vice president, and she's a Black woman. Black women are, I would say, the single most important organizing group within the Democratic Party. And if you fuck them over, we got nothing. We would be so divided. It would be a disaster. They had an organizing call on Zoom earlier in the week.
The first night. The very first night.
Okay. And they broke Zoom at the time. They expected about 1,000 people, which was the capacity. Turned out they had to call the Zoom management because they had 44,000 Black women show up for this call. They raised $1.5 million in a 90-minute call. It was crazy. Well, 2 days ago, I get an email about answer the call, white women show up for Kamala. And at first I went, that's kind of white women. But I was on the call last night, and I was on there from the beginning, and I was on the Zoom. Not only was the 44,000 record broken, they had over 100,000 women, people call in on the Zoom call. They had to do the spillover onto YouTube because Zoom kept breaking. The donate links were so overloaded. It was like, you know, Bruce Springsteen and Taylor Swift went on sale the same day. You couldn't get through. It was, the energy was incredible. I mean, I'm goosebumps just thinking about it. It was, I haven't had that feeling in, you know, in a long, long time. It felt really good. I do have hope. For the first time in a while, I have hope. And I think a lot of people felt that way. The call was organized. It was the idea of Shannon Watts of Moms Demand Action, right? And she put together this group, and the people that were visible on the Zoom call, and by the way, it's all up on YouTube. You can get it. Just look, search YouTube for Answer the Call 2024. They also have the website, answerthecall2024.com, where it'll be posted. I'm sure they're going to edit it nicer because it technologically was a mess. I know about those things, doing a show on YouTube every day. But there were Pink was on the call. She called in from Stockholm, Sweden. She said it was 3 o'clock in the morning. She just got off stage. She was on the plane.
Now you're shaming me for not calling in where it was 1 in the morning.
Well, hey,
that was cruel, Nicole.
Well, but you know, she's Pink, and she had been just performing and got on the plane to fly home, and she said, I just heard about this like an hour ago, and I couldn't not be here. And she stayed on for the whole time over the Wi-Fi from her plane flying back from Stockholm, and she couldn't have been more genuine and more real. It was great. There were celebrities, there were regular people, there were organizers, you know, a lot of those kind of people. But I pulled one
Shannon
clip.
Shannon Watts, the kind of quintessential
Shannon Watts,
cross with that,
who was great. And in fact, I will link in the show notes today that I post at NicoleSandler.com. I'll make sure you have them for EmptyWheel.net as well. Shannon Watts' segment was really, it was an organizing call. They had 160,000 women, allegedly, all call in to learn these things on how to organize, how to get involved. And so they had the Black women, the Black men, I think Asian American women. They had all these different calls, and the white women, which a lot of the speakers addressed, that the ick of it. But hey, you know what? Why not? We are here, and white women basically are the ones who elected Trump last time. So it's up to us to step up, and they did. But she gave some practical organizing advice. There's another call on Sunday night. I think it's 7 p.m. Eastern, for women for Harris. So it's bringing all the groups together and really getting down to the nitty gritty. And it was nice to see. It felt like grassroots organizing like it used to be. But there was one speaker that, I want to bring up the video so you could see her, because I know, you know, you being from Michigan, Marcy Wheeler, one of Michigan's favorite daughters, and we love her.
She's the next generation. She's not even like, we have rock stars at the top of the ticket, and she's who's coming in from the bench.
Yes. So here's a little bit of Mallory McMorrow. Let me just play this, and I'll get the video fixed.
In Michigan in 2022, and I was very intentional in my response in identifying myself as a straight white Christian married suburban mom who knows that hate will only win when people like me and all of you on this call stand by and let it happen. This is not the time for us to start a book club. This is not the time for us to talk to each other or learn about things that, frankly, we should have learned decades ago. This is the time for us to act every single day for the next 102 days. This is a muscle that you have to learn how to build, and I know that it's going to be uncomfortable to start. I'm going to level some uncomfortable truths. A lot of people, when they get into this work, they want to do the easy thing. I am reporting in from one of those battleground states right here in Michigan. Nobody here is going to be convinced if they get a postcard in the mail from a stranger in California. You have to donate, you have to knock doors, you have to make phone calls, and you have to talk to people you know. I know that that is one of the scariest, most uncomfortable things you can do. A lot of people just want to talk to strangers. But I want you to think about following up on all of the incredible tips that Shannon shared. The networks that you have in your life, you have a lot of them. You have your kids,
school, parents. So it went like that. I don't want to obviously spend the whole time listening, but I encourage people to watch this video. And because it is up on YouTube, obviously you can fast forward through parts that you think aren't interesting. But I'll tell you something. This went on for a few hours. They raised $2 million. And that's with the links to the donation places overloaded. So I'm still on a high from last night. I was so impressed by it. I couldn't believe what I was watching.
Yeah, no, I mean, and I think that this needed to happen anyway, but I think people just were despondent, and they needed, you know, unfortunately, they needed a kick in the ass.
Yes.
And they needed to believe, and a lot of people had stopped believing. So there you are. Now I want to look at, can we go look at her? So remember what happened was Kamala gets Biden's nomination. And in the first 24 hours, the first 36 hours, she raises $100 million and she basically gets the delegates she needed to win the nomination. Now, there's something interesting here because I spent a lot of time beating up on stupid journalists. The mainstream journalists were tracking who had not yet endorsed her. So like the Obamas, their endorsement was only rolled out this morning.
That's right.
They did. It turns out they did on a call Wednesday endorse her.
Right.
And all this press yesterday was like, oh, they're going to endorse soon. It's like now we know they already did on a call. Right. Like that's the discovery. But they were tracking who hasn't endorsed yet. And people like Tanya at Bolts, Daily Coast, a couple of like left-leaning weedy people were like, no, you don't count who hasn't endorsed. You count, have they gotten the 50% plus one delegates that they need to win on a first round vote?
Right.
And so Tanya was the one, Bolts, if you don't follow his work, you should do it immediately because okay. He's brilliant. T-A-N-I-E-L is his Twitter name. His real name is Daniel, because they're smart. They're like, what we need to know is when she hits that 50 plus one, right? We don't care if Barack Obama is taking his own sweet time. We care about the 50 plus one. And so it was telling that these lefty weedy people knew exactly when she hit. And of course she hit. And this was probably not a mistake either when Nancy Pelosi and the California delegation endorsed and that put her over the top. There's a lot of so-called political journalists have completely lost track of how these political procedures work. Mm-hmm. Right. And so they were chasing stuff as they've been chasing stuff for 2 years. And it was just another one of these moments where they missed where to be looking and therefore were late to reporting something. And anyway, so then Kamala's basically got the nomination by late afternoon on Monday. And then her first speaking engagement after having kept Joe's campaign managers, she's going to add some people, but after having kept Joe's campaign manager, was she went to Wilmington and gave a speech. First, Doug thanked the Bidens, and then she gave this speech, and it was her first rollout of what is thus far her speech, her, mm-hmm. you know, and it was a really good speech, and it was tearful, and, you know, part of her, like her speech is several parts. There's one part where she gets everyone riled up, one part where she talks about Joe Biden and what they have accomplished together, one part, and this is where I think we're going to turn to, where she talks about us moving forward as opposed to moving back like Trump.
Right,
she uses Project 2025 as a pivot.
Yeah, but this is from not from that. So that was the Delaware thing when Biden called in when he was still at home with COVID. Right. But then
she goes her first, and this was already scheduled. She goes to Milwaukee.
Thank you. Yes.
Where Trump has just gotten the nomination, and so what we're going to look at is her first public rollout of her new stump speech. And we're going to look at a one particular moment of it, and it was mobbed. But I mean, imagine being a woman at that. And understanding that this may be the first campaign event in what gets the first woman elected president.
Imagine
being a woman who already had tickets. You know, you've already got it in your schedule. You're going to show up to Milwaukee at 2 p.m. on a weekday. And then you walk in and all of a sudden she's the presidential nominee. This is her first rollout as presidential nominee. Now let's go.
Okay. So she had just been talking about Project 2025 and all the things that are in that plan that's right there on the internet. In fact, hold on, before I put on the video, this the clip where she says, let me go to here.
We'll weaken the middle class. Like, we know we got to take this seriously. And can you believe they put that thing in writing?
Can you believe they put that thing in writing? Was just a
and
great...
that was an ad from what she said in Wilmington. So we're beginning to see her grow comfortable with this stump speech. She had included that line in Wilmington. She had included the, can you believe they wrote it down? But now it's becoming this central line.
Right.
Another central line, which we don't have saved, I think, but like, she rolls out the, I've prosecuted, abuse, sexual abuse. I've prosecuted fraud. And then she says, I know his type. And the first time she said that, it was a very effective line. And the second time she said this, and I don't know if any woman had this feeling, second time she said it, immediately, viscerally, I started thinking of all the sleaze bags who had abused me or treated me like shit or, you know, cheated on me with their ex-girlfriend on my birthday. You know, like immediately that summoned for me the kind of shithole men that Donald Trump is sort of embodies. So that's was right. A great line. But now we're going to go to this moment in her first rally speech, yes, after basically becoming the nominee, and this moment that I thought was remarkable.
Okay, this is in Milwaukee. Here we go.
America has tried these failed economic policies before, but we are not going back.
The crowd goes wild.
We are not going back.
There's this moment, and you can see in her face,
where the crowd is now chanting, we're not going back, and she looks a little surprised.
She's still trying to figure out how to let them go, and she all of a sudden realizes.
And I'll tell you why we're not going back. Because ours is a fight for the future.
Okay, so the crowd picked up on that, we're not going back, and they took off, and she there was this look of like, wow, they're taking
over.
Holy shit,
what did I just do? Right. And the crowd, all of these people, and many of them women, right, who realize that they are at the kickoff of what will hopefully be the election of the first woman president in the United States. And they start screaming, and there's so much there, and a lot of it is about choice, you know, but it's not just about choice. And they take over for a minute, and they're like, no, we're not going back. And Kamala's like, whoa.
Now,
it was this wonderful moment.
You thought they were going to pick up on a different line in that same segment. That's what she thought, that they were going to, you know, echo back. But the we're not going back line, the reaction and the echoing of that and the chanting of it that went on for a while took her by surprise. So you don't know what's going to resonate. And that did.
And, you know, as we look forward to the RNC, like, so within that
the
first
DNC.
Day,
right,
in time for the Wilmington event, right? Mm-hmm. So she had it teed up for the Wilmington event. She'd reached out to Beyonce and gotten permission to use Freedom.
Yes.
And so that's her walk-on music.
Right.
And
it's also in her, the first official campaign video they put out, like, a, you know, more than an ad, but not a full one. So it's on there. Of course, I played it on the show yesterday and immediately got a copyright hit from YouTube. It's like, you know what? It's in her video. It should be fair use. So I have to fight with them on that. But yeah, so good on that. Now there's all these rumors. Beyonce hasn't officially endorsed yet, but she's letting her use the music. So yeah. So there are rumors now.
I mean, what you should expect is we're going to see these celebrity endorsements, right? And this is exactly what Trump was terrified of with Joe Biden, but they're all going to come really naturally to Kamala for a variety of different reasons.
Yes.
Not least that Kamala has better taste in music than Joe Biden does, but no offense to Joe Biden, but
she's
Kamala,
younger.
I mean,
right?
One of the things I saw this week was, you know, they were trying to dig up like this hilarious thing where these Republicans like dig up old videos of her and think she's being weird.
The dance.
And one of them was her getting a Charles Mingus vinyl.
Oh, wow.
And
I
was like,
that one.
You know, like that's not going to, there's so many of these. They're like, oh, look at her admitting that she smoked dope. I'm like,
hello.
Honey, that's not going to hurt her electorally in the year 2024, right?
No,
like,
that's not.
I'm sorry. That buying Charles Mingus albums, being brat, that none of that, you're not going to win the election that way.
No.
Or laugh. Like how, you know, they really did for 3 days, the DEI shillbilly hires in Mar-a-Lago were like, we're going to make fun of her for her laugh. I'm like, no, you're not going to make fun of her. A smart girl laughing is not going to win you the election. It's just not.
Well, and the video of her dancing with the kids in the drum line, I thought was awesome. The first time I saw it, I said, that's great. And then
it's always been awesome. And you know what I was thinking the other day, Nicole, is some of those girls look like they're 13 in that video.
Yeah.
So some of those girls,
they're voting,
may be able to vote for her in November.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Absolutely. And again, my thought was, that's great. Then I found out they're trying to use it as an attack, but the attacks on her.
Yeah. Remember how Donald Trump challenged Joe Biden to golf? Like, Kamala should just said, okay, we'll have a dance off.
Oh my God. And we've seen Trump
we'll dance. She's a great dancer too. And he like does his stupid
YMCA
dance, like old man, stiff hip YMCA dance.
Yeah, it's just the contrasts are amazing. So where was I going to play? I was going to play something. Oh, so the attacks on Kamala Harris. Of course, they are coming and they're just beginning. So from the dancing and her laugh and the DEI nonsense, they can't help themselves. I don't know if you heard this one. On CNN the other day, they played this clip. I don't know what it was from. I think, it's from Fox Business. I don't know if you heard this or not. This was just lovely. A guy named Alec Lace, who is on Fox Business Channel. I've never watched it, so I don't know. But listen, I mean, this is where they're going.
Yeah, and then there's the DEI press secretary telling you that the DEI vice president is the future of the party here. And so the future looks kind of dim for the Democrats here, but this is no shocker either. Kamala Harris, she's the original Hawk-Tua girl. That's the way she got where she is. And the party's going downhill if it's in her hands.
That was tough. That was harsh.
That was tough. That was harsh. That's their pushback. And Sean Duffy's on set laughing. The Hawk-Tua, I guess it was a internet sensation where someone made a comment about a woman performing oral sex on a man. I the whole thing is so distasteful, but this is where they are. It's the old Joe and the hoe. They are really going there. And I saw a meme the other day that I couldn't help but think, yeah, which is, can you imagine what they'd be saying if Kamala Harris had 5 children from 3 different husbands?
Is 1, 2, 3?
Yeah.
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 Yeah. I've lost track of how many Donald Trump
3
actually has.
Right.
How many,
5 children from 3 different women.
And fucked a porn star.
And committed
crimes to cover it up. And
on and on.
I mean, like, if you want to talk about sex life, we can talk about sex life. But let's talk about sex life. If you want to talk about DEI hires, let's talk about the fact that J.D. Vance, and this might be a segue, but maybe we still have to talk about Kamala. Let's talk about the fact that J.D. Vance is Don Jr. picked him.
Mm-hmm.
Don Jr., who Michael Cohen, and as late as 2019, it was like, Donald Trump believes that Don Jr. has really terrible judgment. Don Jr. picked J.D. Vance.
With a little help from Peter Thiel.
I don't know whether they vetted this guy or just figured it wouldn't matter. But anyway, like, J.D. Vance is Donald Trump's notion of white trash, of what white trash is, right? J.D. Vance is Peter Thiel's errand boy.
That's right.
Let's be honest.
Yep.
And that's being polite because Peter Thiel isn't his only master. But you know, like, the notion that Donald Trump, who was born into billions, would pick J.D. Vance's already discredited hillbilly narrative.
Yep.
And say, that's authentic. That's going to help me win votes in Pennsylvania, after he wildly underperformed Republicans in Ohio when he won in 2022. I mean, he won, but barely. He won in a red state, but barely. And that's who they think is going to help Donald Trump. And, oh, by the way, going back to McMorrow, she already made fun of him for drinking Diet Mountain Dew.
Oh my
God. She took a picture she had from like a late night legislative session with her Mountain Dew there right on the podium. And she said, you know, real people know it. You either do no dew or a real dew or full dew. So.
Right. But I don't know if you saw this. There's a video. Hold on. I'm trying to find it.
Oh yeah. He's pushing diet
oh my
dew
God.
Again. I'm
the like, whole thing is just, it is beyond absurd. Here on what powers the camp. This is, if I hadn't seen this myself, I would have thought this was, you know, Saturday Night Live came back early. On what powers the campaign. Look at this.
Hey guys, J.D. Vance here in Radford, Virginia. I thought I'd take you behind the scenes a little bit. When you get to an event, they've got a ton of crap for you to drink and eat. You got 3 bottles of Diet Mountain Dew, about a dozen Snickers, a bag of chips. If I ate even half this stuff, of course, I'd balloon up like crazy. This is the energy that powers the presidential and vice presidential campaign. Of course, I'm honored to be supporting President Trump. I'm honored to be his running mate. If you want to help us.
Okay, so but that's what powers the campaign. Snickers and other candies and Diet Mountain Dew. What? And that's they put that out as a campaign video.
And the campaign video, it still said Trump for president. It doesn't have Vance in there yet. You got to believe that there are these neo-Nazi chat rooms where they're all panicking because they've convinced Donald Trump, Don Jr., to push J.D. Vance with Daddy. And he succeeded. And now J.D. Vance is flopping because the reason he's flopping is because people hate them and their policies. And J.D. Vance has for years just gone out there and said, you know, childless cat ladies.
Hello. Wait, I've got that too. So for those who hadn't heard this, this is from 2021. So not that long ago, he's on with, you know, America's favorite racist, Tucker Carlson, and this.
We're effectively run in this country via the Democrats, via our corporate oligarchs, by a bunch of childless cat ladies who are miserable at their own lives and the choices that they've made, and so they want to make the rest of the country miserable too. And it's just a basic fact. You look at Kamala Harris, Pete Buttigieg, AOC, the entire future of the Democrats is controlled by people without children. And how does it make any sense that we've turned our country over to people who don't really have a direct stake in it?
Oh my God. You know, put aside the fact that he's wrong. Kamala Harris is a stepmother to two teenagers who call her Mama,
and
by
Buttigieg
the way.
Was in the process of adopting and described that this came in a time when he and Chasten were struggling to get through the adoption process.
Yep. And, you know, how dare he? I mean, really, how dare he? I know you commented on, you know, your situation, the assumptions that he's making. I could very easily be one of those childless women. I adopted on my own 20 years ago. I adopted my daughter from an orphanage in Kazakhstan. We come about families in different ways. And how dare he say anything like this? And now it's coming back to bite him in the ass, as it should.
And meanwhile, Elon's trans daughter is absolutely ripping him to shreds on social media and in an interview for the first time. And as she described, he wasn't there when she was a kid. He was an absent parent. And yet now he's lying about what led to her transitioning. You know, I think one of the problems with Don Jr. picking J.D. Vance is those people live in a bubble. They don't realize how weird they are. And Kamala's campaign used that word, weird.
Weird.
And she said in 2020, what are you going to do if you debate Donald Trump? She's like, I'm going to ask him why he's so weird. I mean, Donald Trump is weird. All of these right wingers are weird. And no one has called them out on that. And now, like, all of a sudden, it's like, it is weird to sit there and say that all women have to bear children and they're not legitimate, even if they go to Kazakhstan and adopt a daughter, right? Like that's, but meanwhile, it's okay to disown your daughter because she transitions and lie about her and say, well, you know, she was mildly autistic and that's why she transitioned, not because, you know, it's like he said that. He literally said that, God. Little shithole. And so, you know, so one thing we're discovering is that the Republicans are in a bubble. And at times like this, a national campaign, they don't realize that calling childless women cat ladies isn't going to work, right? and by the way, like the other thing that's going on is all of the potential VP candidates it's like speed dating. They've got 2 weeks to make their case. And it's so much fun. First of all, because these are a bunch of wonderful white men, right?
Yeah,
like they're all hilarious. They're funny. Most of them have really good policies with like maybe one or two exceptions. Mark Kelly is fixing some of his labor policies because he really wants the job. So that's super fun. But Tim Walz got on TV and he's like, just go on the internet and look at what happens to you if you attack cat ladies. Like, I mean, Tim Walz is like the oldest of the crowd, and he's hilarious on TV.
He's
and
the
well
governor of Minnesota, for those who, you know, just putting it.
He's done such a, you know, like he's hilarious on TV. He comes off as like a father figure, but he's been incredibly effective at pushing progressive policies with a bare majority in Minnesota. But he's also great, you know, like he also did this video with his daughter doing the some like diving ride at the Minnesota Fair, and you know, she jumped in about eating turkey because she's vegetarian. You know, it's like, it's really human.
Good.
And
yes.
And this is something that I, you know, going back to the contrast between the Hunter Biden trial and the Donald Trump trial, is the other thing you're seeing is you're seeing partisan loyalty, almost this mafioso loyalty contrasted with love.
Mm-hmm.
Right. We saw it in the Hunter Biden trial. We saw unconditional love. And now as we roll out these family, Kamala's blended family, Tim Walz's daughter at the fair, Buttigieg talking about the joy of adopting his kids, you're contrasting two different notions of family. This like forced parenting versus unconditional love with whoever you end up with. And it's a remarkable contrast. So it's going to be interesting.
You know, you brought up the human part, and it just last night on this call, I keep going back to the call. Pink. I don't know if this is. I think I just made notes. I think this is the spot. I just have to share this with you. Hopefully, this is the right clip because she was brilliant. I said afterwards, I'm a Pink fan now. The only song I know from Pink is Dear Mr. President, she did with the Indigo Girls, because I'm an Indigo Girls fan. But now I'm going to go listen to her music because I fell in love with her last night. So this is Pink on the Zoom call last night from the plane coming back from Stockholm, where she just finished a show. And hopefully this is the right part.
It's not about which candidate is perfect. It's which candidate is human and wants to keep us all human. Which candidate is going to inspire us?
Yeah, so she went on to that that human thing, and anyway, when you brought that up, it's what resonated with me. I encourage everyone to watch it because she said a lot of great things there. But you can hear it's about humanity. It's be human, you know, as opposed to what we're being given from the other side. You know, one more thing before we move on from J.D. Vance. You got to wonder, Donald Trump, this is the best he could do. The guy who is on record saying things about him, you know, America's Hitler, things like
Donald Trump, if nothing else, is relatable to the average working class American because he speaks off the cuff. He's clearly unfiltered and unrehearsed. And there is something relatable about that, even if, you know, half of the things that he says don't make any sense or a quarter of the things that he says are offensive. There's something to be said about relatability. I'm going to vote third party because I can't stomach Trump. I think that he's noxious and is leading the white working class to a very
white
dark place.
Class, right.
And ultimately, I just don't share Hillary Clinton's politics. I'm a never Trump guy. I never liked him.
And there's one.
I can't stomach Trump. I think that he's noxious.
All right, I played that one. But yeah, he's on record saying all these horrible things, and now this is his running mate? This is the best he could do?
Oh, like I said, Don Jr. picked him.
Yeah.
Don Jr. has always been Donald Trump's weak flank, because Don Jr., and it was funny because like in the period where Joe Biden was considering whether or not to drop, he was, as he always does, consulting with his family, and his family happens to include a convicted felon, Hunter Biden. Right. Yep. And so all of these reporters were like, oh, my God, can you believe Hunter Biden is in the room? And I'm like, you know what? Every single time Donald Trump has a strategy discussion, there's a convicted felon in the room, and you're not you have no problem with that at all. And there's often when Paul Manafort is included, there's a convicted felon whose crimes are similar to Hunter Biden's, but an order of magnitude bigger and worse and more problematic for America. But Don Jr. is only not a criminal convict for want of, you know, like he was implicated in both the Trump Foundation fraud and the New York State fraud. He is a fraudster, just like Dad. He also often appears on video seemingly under the influence of something. He waggles guns around all the time, which would seem to suggest he could be prosecuted with some of the same things that Hunter Biden has. I mean, the guy is only different from Hunter Biden in that he's obviously stupider and obviously has worse judgment and obviously hangs out with a far worse crowd than Hunter Biden. I have nothing for Hunter Biden, but like the neo-Nazis that Donald Trump admittedly hangs out in chat rooms with are very ugly people, very, very ugly people. And this is the man You know, and they all influence him. They all know that if they get to Don Jr., they can get to Dad. Like, Roger Stone is the other person that's true of. But Roger Stone is savvy. I mean, he's an evil dick, but he's a hell of a lot smarter, and a hell of a lot better judge of some things than Don Jr. is, right? Mm-hmm. Don Jr. is just a mess. And so you get to Don Jr. and you get to Donald Trump. And that is what led to the pick of J.D. Vance, probably with a bunch of money being dangled by Peter Thiel and the like, right? So, And for those people, they don't care about Donald Trump, honestly. And that was the, like, Tucker Carlson was like, oh, Don, you have to make sure you don't hire anyone that the CIA would take out. I'm like, right, so the FSB would happily take out Donald Trump if he doesn't deliver Ukraine on a silver platter this time around, because right. J.D. Vance is going to be a far more reliable pawn for Vladimir Putin than Donald Trump is, just because he is a tool who is sort of, you know, he doesn't have Donald Trump's epic narcissism. He doesn't have Donald Trump's stubbornness. J.D. Vance has been a chameleon to do whatever he could to get ahead. And right now, Peter Thiel is the guy who pulls those strings. And Peter Thiel is not somebody that you want pulling the strings of the guy running the United States. He's simply not.
No.
So it was a terrible choice, but it was a choice of people who live in a bubble, and it was a choice of people who can get to Don Jr. And impress him. And he is very easy to impress because he's got lousy judgment and he's not very smart. So that's how we got to this place. And, you know, and it's kind of crazy because people are like, you know, the Republicans have already launched two lawsuits to try and make it difficult for Kamala to take over for Joe Biden, because the Republicans are pissed off, right? Because they're not prepped for Kamala Harris. Oh, as I said, for 6 years, Republicans, Donald Trump, and the Republicans, Donald Trump, and the Russian government have been colluding together to, like, soften Joe Biden. And now they're sitting here with Kamala Harris and they're like, holy shit, we don't know anything besides racism and sexism. What do we do? So they're trying to launch all these lawsuits to make it difficult for Kamala. And there's going to come a time where Donald Trump is going to say, I hate that J.D. Vance is stealing the attention from me. I hate that J.D. Vance makes me look terrible. Mm-hmm. I hate that J.D. Vance sometimes wear shirts that buckle and he's not dressed properly. And so there will come a point where Donald Trump is going to be like, is there any way I can get rid of this guy? And J.D. Vance has been picked by the party. Like, right, Kamala got on. Kamala, you know, Joe Biden dropped and Kamala picked up before the party spoke. But right. J.D. Vance, Donald Trump is stuck with J.D. Vance. Like, this was something that was true. If Mike Pence had been smarter about the assassination attempts that were waiting for him on January 6th, he would have done something to get rid of Trump earlier. Or he would have, I mean, you know, like, this is something that Dick Cheney knew, is if you're the vice president, you are the constitutional officer and they can't take you out. And that's going to be true of J.D. Vance if Trump were to win. And I think, you know, Trump has to be thinking about how that guy is going to shiv him. Because he will.
And here's the tell, not, you know, one of many, but, you know, regarding the debate. So there was a second debate scheduled, I think, for September between Trump and Biden on ABC. Now, and Kamala's like, oh, I'm in. We'll do it. And now he's saying, we're not going to schedule any debates now because they might still change. After this week, the Democratic Party is not looking, they're not going to change. Kamala Harris will be the nominee. If anyone's going to change, it might be him with Vance, if it's possible. But they already had their convention, and Vance was nominated and accepted the nomination. So he's the guy, right?
Yeah. And I mean, Donald is chicken. And Donald, you know, he sat there for 3 days just truth socialing against Joe Biden. It's like, honey, you gotta give it up.
Oh my God. One other thing, the people, you know, Donald, only the best people. I know we have a mutual friend in Jason Leopold, who these days is doing the FOIA files for Bloomberg. I don't know if you saw, he's got a newsletter that comes out every Friday morning. And his today is epic. They finally came up with things that he asked for 7 to 10 years ago. when Michael Flynn's security clearance was suspended, and more congressional inquiries into FBI communication. But the Michael Flynn thing is interesting. There's a lot of stuff there. I don't know if you've seen it yet. I'm sure you will look at it.
Oh, yeah, so, I saw the Flynn stuff. One thing that's interesting about the Flynn stuff, and there's two IG reports. It's like the DOJ IG department is unleashing all of the reports they did on Bill Barr. And they all say what he did was not illegal, but this has never been done before. Like, he's interfering. Like, it shows that he, like, ordered everyone to rewrite the sentencing for Roger Stone. I will have a lot more to say about that. And same thing, like, he was involved in announcing an investigation into 9 ballots from outside of Scranton, Pennsylvania, that some mentally ill man had gotten rid of, thinking that they were spoiled. There's at least one more coming about Barr, so we're not done yet. But we're still digging stuff up from 2017.
Oh yeah, and further back too. So there's more stuff coming, and I hate to say it, but we're prepared for it. And they mentioned it quite a few times on the call last night. Look, we may be all feeling really good right now. The other side is ruthless, and they know no shame. And the attacks, we ain't seen nothing yet, because they're gonna come at Kamala and the Democrats with everything. And I'd say probably 99.9% of it's bullshit. But they don't care. That's what they do. I saw a notice early this morning from somebody who works in election, training election workers. And they put out a notice that to watch out when you go, if you vote in person, and they make any mark on your ballot, get a new ballot, because that's the way they might get your ballot rendered, not usable. Dirty tricks. We're going to have to look out for dirty tricks, because this is what they do. I have no worry that they would win. Remember, in 2016, Trump didn't win the popular vote. They will, and of course, Donald Trump, the best was to, here's a clip. This is just from the other day, and again, it's a tell.
But Mr. President, real quickly, is there a plan, though, for when it comes to early voting and ballot harvesting, the legal way, since the Democrats have made it legal, is there a plan for the Republicans to get out there, door knock, and get those ballots?
Oh, yes. We have a tremendous group of people, thousands, tens of thousands of people all over the country. We have poll watchers, the likes of which we've never had before. Whether you like it or not, they cheat on elections. They cheat. That's what they do the best. They're no good at policy. They're no good on the border. They're no good with the economy. But they cheat like hell. That's what they're good at. We have lawyers at every poll booth. We have my instruction, we don't need the votes. I have so many votes. I'm in Florida now, and I drove to another location.
Okay, we don't need the votes. We have so many votes. We have lawyers. We have poll watchers. He's telling people we don't need your stinking votes.
He's been saying this for a while, and I Tim Alberta did a piece in the Atlantic. Like, he did a long piece in the Atlantic about the plan to win, and I wrote it up at the time. It was only like a week and a half ago. It was before Biden dropped, though, and he said, you know, there was a throwaway line where they said, you know, they're relying on it being Biden, but also in there they said they got rid of the field operation and replaced it with lawyers, replaced it with Christina Bob. And I said then, like, this is not an operation that plans to win an election. It's an operation that plans to legitimize an insurrection.
That's right.
And now Alberta has done a follow up on how they're screwed, because it's not Biden. And, one of the interesting things, and I don't know, maybe we need to drop it there, because or not. But one of the interesting things that was not noticed that I did notice is that after Biden stepped down, Merrick Garland issued a statement. And he, as far as I know, he's the only cabinet member who did. But he issued a statement saying, I'm going to stay here and continue the fight to protect civil rights. That is the issue before us. And I've been puzzling through that ever since. And my guess is that he's aware that this is about the election, that Merrick Garland sees his task going forward the next 6 months and Biden's task. And again, this is why I think it's really useful that you have an executive and a candidate now, is to protect the vote, is to ensure the integrity of the vote. So we'll see how that works. But I know that DOJ and FBI are prosecuting shit tons of people who are threatening all kinds of people, a lot of politicians, but also election workers. So, you know, we'll see.
Yeah. But again, this is what, you know, a major part, if not 50% or more, of what we need to guard ourselves against are the dirty tricks. Remember, I think Ellie Mistal said it, every accusation is a confession from Trump. When he said, you know, we don't need your votes, we've got the lawyers, all they do is steal. They know how to steal. Everything he accused them of doing is exactly what their plan is. It's very obvious. He's not, you know, he may be cunning, but
he's not subtle.
No. And he says the quiet part out loud. Listen to what he's saying. Just like Project 2025. Can you believe they put that in writing?
Yeah. And it's a huge problem for them. And Donald Trump is like, oh, it's not me. And certain Trump whispers were like, no, it's not really him. And then J.D. Vance comes out and writes the introduction for Roberts's book for the heritage guy who wrote the book. Oh, so God. It's like, it is your thing. You will own it. And that is, you know, even for people who are not Democrats, that was already mobilizing people before Kamala put a face at the top of the ticket. And now those two things changed the outlook for it a lot.
Wow. Marcy Wheeler, we've come basically to the end of the hour. Obviously, more happened this week because it was 16 years long. I guess one of the big things, and you wrote about it a lot this week at emptywheel.net, was the gunshot. And when we started, you said he was shot, and I said he was shot at. There is now legitimate questions on what cut his ear. Was it a bullet? Was it shrapnel from, you know, shit that got hit legitimately? And now we hear Ronnie Jackson's nephew also got hit with some flying shrapnel.
Well,
he said that
before he saw Trump. And so it's interesting because he said that on July 14th. He said, my nephew got sliced on the neck. He was sitting right in the VIP area. There were four cops who also got hit by shrapnel, at least that we know of. And so Republicans... So what happened was Chris Wray on testimony on Thursday said that the FBI is not sure whether it was a bullet or a shrapnel. And yep. Look, I don't actually care. I really don't care. It is, frankly, we should care more if it were a bullet, because if it were a bullet, it could create delayed brain damage, right? Yep. So if it were a bullet, then we need to know that too. I started harping on this. Josh Marshall was there before me, but mm-hmm. I started harping on this because, you know, there's this boiled frog thing that has happened where Donald Trump won't release his medical records. And the people who cover him are like, well, he's not going to give it to me. I'm like, well, make that the story then.
Right.
Make that the story. If he will not give you the medical records, that is the story. And that is the story. And frankly, that's what you did to Joe Biden.
Like,
you guys chased this fucking Parkinson's conspiracy theory based on nothing. And yet you're unwilling to make for a week straight the story, Donald Trump refusing to give his medical records. So he rolled out Ronnie Jackson. And that's when I first got suspicious, because when you bring in Ronnie Jackson, you do it for propaganda purposes.
Of course, because you can't get a real doctor
Ronnie Jackson's
to do
out
it.
With. Ronnie Jackson's out with a second statement since we've been on air, since we've been taping. Remember, tape it noon East time. Yeah, it'll come out. It'll come out later. I mean, it'll come out. It'll be there when we get off. But the funny thing is, Ronnie Jackson, before he saw Trump, because he Trump got released from the hospital. He spoke to Ronnie Jackson. Ronnie Jackson got on a plane and flew to Mar-a-Lago. And then that was the medical care that Trump had. Trump has a different physician, so he wasn't getting follow-up care with his physician. He was getting follow-up care with a propagandist.
Yeah.
And a propagandist who has done propaganda for his campaign. And so Ronnie Jackson some days ago said, let me tell you about the wound, two centimeter wound. We're like, you know, you're a liar, so I don't believe you. That's when I first got suspicious. Then Ray says, we're not sure. And again, I don't care which it is. Give us the medical records.
Right.
Just give us the medical records. Now, the other interesting thing is, so me, Josh Marshall, and then Ryan Noble, who is, you know, at NBC, he's like, people are beginning to pick it up. They're like, what happened? And now New York Times and the FBI has asked Trump for an interview.
Yeah.
And, you know, if Trump does an interview, he has to tell the truth. And they're going to ask him for the medical records that he won't release publicly. The FBI has already done interviews with over 400 people, according to Chris Wray. They have not done an interview with the chief intended target of the shooting.
Wow. Wow.
So that, you know, like, I don't care whether it's a bullet or whether it's shrapnel. I really don't care. I care that you are ruling out Ronnie Jackson instead of giving us your medical records. And I will care a lot if you refuse to sit down for an interview with the FBI.
Yes.
And that's, you know, and I care that the people covering Donald Trump have, like, allowed themselves to sit there in a pot of water with the temperature slowly going up, and they have boiled. They are frogs that have boiled, and they're just like, oh, I'm sorry, I can't get any kind of response from Donald Trump. And it's like, no, 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 no. We are having an election, and this is the opportunity to change things, to say, like, he's not president right now.
Yep. All right.
You don't have to defer to him. You can say, I will report every single day that you are refusing to release your medical records until you release them. You can do that.
Yes. And they should.
They won't in New York Times because Joe Conchard steps down, just like Joe Biden did.
But, there you go.
But other outlets have the ability to do that.
They do. And they don't. And therein lies one of the problems, one of many, but a big one. Again, Joe Biden, the reason that that whole neurologist story, the Parkinson's chase even happened, was because they released visitor logs and they could see that this doctor made numerous visits to the White House. They didn't bother to do any further checking before they accosted Karine Jean-Pierre in the briefing room. But, you know, they don't bother. It's like, oh, he won't give it to us. Oh, well, I guess we're out of luck. So,
yeah. And it's just, there is nothing that demonstrates the double standard applied to Democrats and to Donald Trump than the sheer unwillingness to make an issue out of the fact that he refuses to give up his medal records. I mean, there's no excuse for it. And, you know, it's not like, if he won't give it to you, that's the story.
Right. By the way, in the 4 years he was in office, he still never released his tax returns. Just saying, you know, I guess it's okay if you're Donald Trump. I don't know. And you're the media. Marcy Wheeler, there's much more. So we'll do this again next week. Any predictions on what could possibly happen in the next 7 days?
You know, the Olympics is going to take some distraction out of things. Although there was sabotage of the TGV before the Olympics. Yesterday, the French arrested this Russian chef because he was planning sabotage. He got really drunk on his way across Europe. And Hungary opened the Schengen borders to Russia. So things are going to get wild in Europe. I wouldn't be surprised if shit goes down with the Olympics in Europe.
Oh,
again, but I think otherwise, you know, you are likely to see, I think you have to see a vice presidential candidate by the end of the week. And so we may know who the candidate is going to be by next week, but it's, you know, again, it's all these great white guys.
Yeah. Out of the top tier, you really can't go wrong. I think I think it's narrowed down to a couple. Mark Kelly, of course, a senator from Arizona, where I now live, seems to be among the top runners, but no point in guessing.
Andy Beshear, who's young, Kentucky, kind of forced his way in there by getting on and saying, JD, you ain't from here. True.
Right.
Like we said, Tim Walz from Minnesota, a big candidate. People always assume Josh Shapiro is going to be big. Roy Cooper, I learned how to pronounce his name this week, is another, like, he is term limited out of North Carolina and is one in North Carolina. And one of the things that we've already seen in the polling is Kamala puts those Southern Belt stories into play in a way that Biden simply wasn't doing. In fact, Georgia has gotten within a point in at least one poll. So picking somebody like Cooper or Andy Beshear, I think would pick up some of those states.
But
so
North Carolina, I think, is in play where Kentucky isn't. But
Kentucky is not in play. But Beshear is good, and Beshear is. You know, I think that Beshear would change the way people look at Democrats because I think Cooper would as well. Mm-hmm. I think Mark Kelly, he's pushing for it pretty hard. It's going to be interesting. Like this week, the story is going to be the VP. I don't know if they'll announce by the time that I think they have to because they're going to hold a vote on the 7th.
Right.
Right.
Yeah.
The 7th I've lost track of time.
Is a week from Wednesday. So it's a week and a half away. The next Friday will be.
So maybe
August
not.
2nd.
Maybe it'll be next Friday after we go on the air because that's what always happens. Yes. That we'll hear who Kamala's vice presidential candidate is. She is going to Georgia on Wednesday, so you're going to see her in some new states.
By the way, the former Republican lieutenant governor of Georgia endorsed Kamala Harris
already. Yep.
Already. So that's big. That's pretty huge. And I'm hoping this might open some floodgates of Republicans saying, yeah, we got to go.
There's a PAC run by people who had endorsed Nikki Haley.
Yes.
And they're in a legal fight already, whether they can say that they endorsed Kamala Harris. Because I suspect that Trump is threatening Nikki Haley and Nikki Haley is threatening the PAC. And the PAC is like, no, you know, we say right there that we're not affiliated with any candidate. We just endorsed Kamala Harris. So you're going to see that. You're going to see some select right-wing men say, you know, I don't know about Kamala Harris. Some of that's racism. Some of that's misogyny. Some of that's, you know, a fear of San Francisco. But it's hilarious because you're seeing these right-wingers go on TV and half of them are saying she was too tough on crime as a cop. Which is true.
Right.
And the other half are saying, you know, she's soft on crime. I'm like, you know, you're the ones who nominated a convicted felon.
That's
like,
right.
You don't get to make that argument anymore about Democrats.
Yeah.
You know, we'll see whether the press continues in their kind of stead ways of, I mean, like the New York Times, I'm going to like full time on the New York Times. They did this thing and a lot of people did, but the New York Times was one of the first. They're like, the pick of Kamala Harris may goad Trump into making racist and sexist attacks. And it's like, no. Trump is an adult. Trump is a 78-year-old man. Trump may choose to run on racism and sexism. That's not goading him. That is him choosing to do what he has always done, which is be a sexist and be a racist. And it's time we held the Republican Party accountable for the racism and sexism that is who they are, rather than suggesting that this is a natural reaction to a Black woman being put on the ticket.
Without a doubt. You know what? We're already in overtime. There's one thing we didn't get to that made my head explode this week. And I don't know if you saw it, but most of us have, a lot of people that I talk to, listeners of my show, have turned off MSNBC. They reached the final straw for me this week where they had Elise Jordan go to Milwaukee and do these focus groups. Did you hear any of this?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, so let me just play for you the one question, just one question that she asked, which set me off. And I did a major rant, I think, a few days this week on it, but I'm still, my jaw dropped. I shouldn't be surprised, but here.
Who do you blame for President Biden being in office in this condition?
Who do you blame for President Biden being in office in this condition? What condition and what blame? I mean, the whole thing, what the fuck?
Before Donald Trump went off on Chris Ray for suggesting it might not be a bullet that hit his ear, he went off on Chris Ray because he was asked repeatedly, you know, have you met with Joe Biden recently? He's like, yeah, totally normal meeting. And this is the thing, like there is this, I mean, I think there is some basis in fact to argue that that Biden's staffers protected him from having to do, one-on-ones. So do Trump's.
Of course.
Always have, right? Like, so that's not new in politics at all.
No.
So you can argue that Biden's staffers were protecting him, but through that entire period until the G7, arguably, people were still saying he's super sharp. I mean, he is still super sharp. He just doesn't speak very well anymore. Right. He walks poorly and sometimes he wanders off, Trump has done always.
Right. Yes.
And Biden has done always, yes, he's not as sharp as he used to be. I am glad we replaced somebody with more stamina.
Yep.
I think he made a good case. Joe Biden did that. But based on his record, he certainly should feel like he should run for a second term, and Kamala's running on that record.
That's right.
And it's like Joe Biden's poll numbers are already going up. The economy continues to do better than anybody predicted, means that the Fed is probably going to do a rate cut in September, which means the economy is likely to be doing even better in November when people vote. And so, everyone and maybe who the fuck am I kidding? But maybe the New York Times will discover that the economy is best in the world. They won't, because
they're the New York Times.
They're holding out for an exclusive. Joe Kahn should step down just like Joe Biden, and for the same reasons and out of the same stubbornness. But Joe Biden is going to start getting credit for the things that he hasn't gotten credit for in the last 6 months. And that is going to be shared with Kamala Harris. And, I'm not making predictions for sure that this will happen. But again, she's already brought more stamina to the race. She's already speaking to choice better. She's upped the enthusiasm. She has the ability to break the double hater stalemate, which has been... So double haters, both the Hillary Trump race and the Joe Biden Trump race, involved, like, there were maybe 40% or 30% of the electorate on both sides who were solidly in support. And then the people, the 40% in the middle, hated both sides, hated Hillary, hated Trump, hated Biden, hated Trump, hate Biden, hated Trump. And so they were choosing not who they liked, but who they disliked less. And in 2020, that was Joe Biden. And it was going to be Donald Trump in 2024. And if Kamala Harris can break that stalemate and make it so 40 or 45% of the electorate is super enthusiastic and going out to vote for Kamala Harris, and the other 25% is like, there's no question that Kamala Harris is better than Donald Trump, then you're going to see a snowball effect. I'm not saying that'll happen. I'm saying if that happens, this will change the nature of the election. If Kamala Harris starts getting credit for things that Joe Biden, for the historic success of the Joe Biden-Harris administration, things, then the election may change dramatically, or we could have a black swan, or, Israel and Russia could do something to help Donald Trump, or Trump can start an insurrection. Those are all possibilities. But two of the possibilities on the table right now are that the entry of Kamala Harris in the race will dramatically affect the electoral landscape of the race in ways that weren't going to happen with Joe Biden.
Right. And I think it already has. That part has begun and it's evident. We'll see what happens. We still have 100 days to go. And
it's 101, isn't it?
I think it's 100. I don't know. It's November. Well, November 5th is election day. What's today? July 26th.
I think yesterday was 102. So I think,
it's there, right around 100 days. It's still, over 3 months. So anything could happen. It's an eternity in political years. All right. Marcy Wheeler, as always, thank you. We'll do it again next week. In the meantime, read up at emptywheel.net. Listen to the Ball of Thread podcast as well.
We've got a new episode that is it's out on Patreon right now, and it's coming out in the next couple of days for non-payers. But there's also, we're doing these extras for Patreon people. And there's a really cool one that LOL GOP is putting out on Steve Bannon's limited hangout, which I love what he did with it. So that's also coming out if you support the Patreon. So go support the Patreon and get that extra in there. And otherwise, the piece that we have coming out for everybody is on how Hipsy helped Donald Trump get away with the Russian investigation.
Okay. It's the Ball of Thread podcast. Just Google Ball of Thread, Marcy Wheeler, Empty Wheel. It'll all come up. Thank you. we'll dig in for next week.
Hang in there.
You too. Take care. Bye.